that if I were you.
Wouldn't do what?
What you were thinking of doing.
How do you know what I was thinking?
Oh, we make it our business to know lots of things.
Look, whatever you're selling, I'm not interested. Please, just leave me alone.
No, you don't understand. I've got a job to do.
I said, leave me alone.
This isn't going very well. Well, you said this was going to be easy.
But he won't listen.
I know. If at first you don't succeed, blah, 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 blah. Have you ever read Tom Sawyer?
What?
Now, there was an industrious young man, and when the chips were down, he never gave up. Remember why?
Who cares?
He never stopped caring about others, George. Not about himself, but about all the folks who needed him.
You just called me George. How did you know my name?
I know everything about you. I've watched you grow up from a little boy.
How could you? I've never seen you before.
Haven't needed you till now.
How's the lip?
Looks like it stopped bleeding.
That's the answer I got to a prayer a little bit ago.
No, George. I'm the answer to your prayer.
Who are you?
Clarence Oddbody. AS2.
Oddbody?
AS2. What's that?
AS2.
Angel. Second class.
Now I know I've lost my mind.
Yeah, but you were well on your way. That's why they sent me down. Besides, it's ridiculous to think of killing yourself for a measly $8,000.
How did you know that?
I've been trying to tell you. I'm your guardian angel. I know everything about you.
Well, you look like the kind of angel I'd get. You do that much.
What about the fallen angel? What happened to your wings? I haven't won them yet, but you're going to change all that.
I am?
How? By letting me help you.
Only way you can help me is give me 8,000 bucks before the clock strikes 12. After that, my life turns into a pumpkin.
Sorry, but we don't use money in heaven.
That's right. I keep forgetting. Well, down here, you can't live without it. And truth be known, I'm worth a lot more dead than alive.
Now look, I've told you. You mustn't say things like that. Why, you don't realize how much it'll work.
If it had been for me, everybody I know would be a lot better off. Everybody! My wife, my kids, my friends.
You sure have got a lot of friends. I'll say that for you. Why, do you know they've blocked our airwaves for over an hour now?
What are you talking about?
Prayers. When they're powerful. When they're heart up through mighty powerful missiles. And, well, the ones for you, they've lit up our whole celestial system.
Why?
How? Because you're such an important influence in so many lives, George. Always have been.
Since when?
Since the day you saved your little brother from drowning when he fell through the ice.
That was instinct. Besides, I was only 12.
There were other boys there that day, George. Some older and better swimmers. They didn't nod to their instinct. Only you did.
He was my brother.
Yes, but what about Gower when you saved him from ruin? That wasn't instinct. That was courage. Deep-seated, wrenched, full of guts, courage.
But he had just received a telegram telling him his son had died.
And he had turned me through and through by drowning his sorrow in a bottle. Remember?
George! Are you out there? I'm sorry, Mrs. Blaine. That medicine should have been over an hour ago. Yes. It'll be over in 5 minutes. Where's Miss Blaine's capsules, and why didn't you deliver them?
I couldn't.
What kind of tricks are you playing at, young man? Don't you know the Blaine's boy's very sick?
You're hurting my sore here, Mr. Gower.
You lazy loafer!
Mr. Gower, you don't know what you're doing. You put something wrong in those capsules.
What are you talking about?
I know you're unhappy. You got that telegram saying it upset you. I understand that. But you put something bad in those capsules. I'm sure you did.
How do you mean?
Just look and see for yourself. I tried to tell you when you were filling the order, but you wouldn't listen. But look at the bottle you took the powder from. It's not right. I swear it isn't.
Oh, no. No. No!
Am I here again? I won't tell anyone, Mr. Gower. I promise. I won't ever tell a soul. Hope to die, I won't.
Oh, George!
And you never did. Not to this day. That's remarkable.
He's always cared about young people. He gave lots of us our first job.
He never stopped caring about you, George. That's for sure. Remember that handsome suitcase he bought you when you thought you were finally heading off to college?
That was 1,000 years ago.
For he's a jolly good fellow, for he's a jolly good fellow, for he's a jolly good fellow, which nobody can deny.
May you always use it in good health, George.
How can I thank you, Mr. Dower?
By graduating with honors. It would make us all very proud.
Fat chance.
Play you a bet, little brother.
Haven't got time. I'm off to my dance. How do I look?
Like a goon in a penguin suit. Where's the funeral?
That's enough, you two. You look very nice, Harry.
Of course he does. It's my tux.
And what's your verdict, Aunt Tilly? Do I look good enough to eat?
If you lay a hand on me, young man, I'll hit you with this purse.
Aunt Tilly, I'm in love with you. There's a full moon out tonight.
Harry, that's enough.
Hey, Mom, I gotta borrow the car. For sure, a couple dozen plates.
Whose plates?
Well, the chairman of the East Committee, Mom. And we're only short a couple dozen.
Now, wait a minute, Harry. You can't use my Sunday china. It was your grandmother's and her mother's before that.
We're all going to miss you, George.
Thank you, Violet.
Say, some dress you got on there.
This little thing? Why, it's just a hand-me-down, like Harry's.
Well, it sure is pretty, isn't it, George?
What? Oh, the dress. Yes, it's real nice, Violet.
Well, I guess I better be going. The dance starts in another half hour. Why don't you drop by later on?
Just might do that.
Hope you do. Goodbye now.
Violet, you want me to walk you over to the school?
That won't be necessary. Take care, George.
Yeah, you too, Violet.
I'll see you around, George.
Say, Uncle Billy, where's Pop?
I had to finish up a special report for Potter. Board meeting's tomorrow.
I thought when Pop put him on the board of directors, he'd ease up on us. What's eating the old money-grabbing buzzard anyway?
Oh, he's a sick man, George. Sick in his mind, sick in his soul if he has one. It's everybody who has anything he can't have. Hates us for him, I'm afraid.
After you graduate, you look good coming to the building alone with us, would you, George?
Not me, Uncle Billy. I couldn't face being cooped up in a shabby little office for the rest of my life. I'm sorry. It's just the thought of spending the rest of my life trying to figure out how to save 3 cents on a length of pipe. I'd go crazy. I want to do something big, something important.
Well, you know, George, your dad and I feel that we're doing something important. It's in the heart and soul of every man who wants his own roof, walls, and a fireplace to sit beside and eat it. You have to feel or help me get those things.
But, Bill, you've got to admit this town is no place for any man unless he's willing to crawl the water. Now, you've got talent, George. We've all seen it. So you go on and get yourself an education, then get out of here if you must.
Have you any idea what you want to do, George?
Sure. I want to build things. Like skyscrapers, maybe even cities. It's been a dream all my life.
Still after that first million before you're 30?
No. I'll settle for half that in cash.
Well, your Aunt Tilly and I are sure gonna miss you.
And I'm going to miss all of you. That's for certain. Mind taking this back into the house for me? I think I'll walk over to the school and drop in on Harry's dance.
Have a good time, sir.
And you did, too. Remember? That's the night you met Mary Hatch. Of course, you had always known Mary. She grew up 3 or 4 years behind you, always there, somewhere in the background, tagging along until one of you boys noticed her and sent her on her way. But that never discouraged her. Not her, or any of the girls, really. They all had their eyes on you, George, especially Violet and Mary. You just never took the bait until Harry's graduation party. That's the night you danced the Charleston with Mary Hatch, until someone tripped the lock on the moving gym floor and everyone fell. Or jumped into the swimming pool.
Buffalo girls, can't you come out tonight? Can't you come out tonight? Can't you come out tonight? Buffalo girls, can't you come out tonight and dance by the light of the moon?
Hot dog, just like a church choir.
Beautiful.
You should have seen all the commotion in that locker room. I had to knock down 3 people to get the stuff we're wearing. I bet over half your class jumped in that pool.
Half the town said it wasn't a good idea to build a gym over a swimming pool. I wonder who turned the key.
Probably someone just jealous because he chose me to dance with you.
You think maybe?
Here, let me hold that old wet dress of yours. Hello.
Hello.
You look at me as if you don't know me.
Well, I don't.
You've passed me on the street almost every day.
Me? That was a little girl named Mary Hatch. That wasn't you.
Do I look as funny as you do?
Well, I guess I'm not quite the football type. You look wonderful. You know, if it wasn't me talking, I'd say you were the prettiest girl in town.
Well, why don't you say it?
I don't know. Maybe I will say it. How old are you anyway?
You can't ask that.
Well, I am.
18.
18? Why, it was only last year. You were 17.
Too young or too old?
Just right. The way it suits you. Yes, sir. You look a little older without your clothes on. You look older. I mean, younger. You look just... Oh, I'm sorry, Mary.
Sir, my train, please.
A pox upon me for mumsy laughs. Your caboose.
You may kiss my hand.
Mary?
As I was lumbering down the street, down the street, down the street.
Okay, then. I'll throw a rock at the old Granville house.
Oh, no, don't. I love that old house.
No, you see, you make a wish, and then try and break some glass. You gotta be a pretty good shot nowadays, too. So many windows are broken out.
Oh, no, George, don't. It's full romance, that old place. I'd like to live
in that old place?
Uh-huh.
I wouldn't live in it as a ghost. Now watch. Right on the second floor there.
What's your wish, George?
Well, not just one wish, but a whole half of Mary. I know what I'm going to do tomorrow, and the next day, and the next year, and the year after that. I'm shaking the dust of this crummy little town off my feet, and I'm going to see the world. Italy, Greece, the Parthenon, the Colosseum, and then I'm going to go to college and see what they know. And then I'm going to build things. I'm going to build airfields. I'm going to build skyscrapers 100 stories high. I'm going to build bridges a mile long. Are you going to throw a rock? Hey, that's pretty good. What's your wish for, Mary?
Buffalo gals, can't you come out tonight? Can't you come out tonight? Can't you come out tonight?
Buffalo gals, can't you come out tonight and dance by the light of the moon?
What'd you wish when you threw that rock?
Oh, no.
Come on, tell me.
If I told you, then it might not come true.
What is it you want, Mary? You want the moon? Just say the word and I'll throw a lasso around it and pull it down. Hey, that's a pretty good idea. I'll give you the moon, Mary.
I'll take it. And then what?
Well, it needs to be swallowed. And it all dissolves, see? And the moon beams would show your fingers, and your toes, and the ends of your hair. Am I talking too much?
Yes, you are. Why don't you kiss her instead of talking her to death?
What?
Oh, you. It's wasted on the wrong people. Just wasted.
Hey! Come on back here! I'll show you some kissing and I'll turn your head around. George, come on quick, your father's in trouble. Huh? Mary, sorry, I've got to go.
Come on, George, just hurry.
Just call the doctor?
Yes, Campbell's there now.
It was nice of you to come, Mr. Potter.
Well, I'd say your father was the building and loan in Bedford Falls, George.
I agree, Mr. Potter.
Of course, he wasn't a businessman, and that's what killed him. Oh, I don't mean any disrespect, God rest his soul. He was a man of high ideals, so-called, but ideals without common sense can ruin this town. So at our next Board of Trustees meeting, I'm going to make a motion.
A motion?
That's right. A motion to dissolve the institution and turn its assets and liabilities over to receivership.
But Mr. Potter, I
take this loan application the board's to act on this morning, to Ernie Bishop. You know, that fellow walks around all day delivering our mail, usually late, because he's always stopping to talk to everyone on his route. Well, I happen to know that the bank turned down his loan, but he came to the building loan and we're willing to build him a house worth $5,000. Why?
Well, you see, Mr. Potter, I already took care of that. You have all his papers there. Salary, his insurance, and I can personally vouch for his character.
So he's a friend of yours?
Yes, sir.
So if you shoot pool with the manager's son, you can borrow money. And what does he get the building in loan? A lazy, discontented rabble instead of a thrifty working class. And all because a few starry-eyed dreamers like your father stirred them up with a lot of impossible ideas.
Just a minute, just a minute. Now hold on, Mr. Potter. You're right when you say my father was no businessman. Why he ever started this cheap, penny-antsy building in loan, I'll never know. Neither you nor anybody else can say anything against his character, because his whole life was, why, in the 25 years since seeing Uncle Billy started the institution, he never once thought of himself or saved any money. But he did help a few people get out of your slums, Mr. Potter. Well, what's wrong with that? Just remember this. The rabble you're talking about, they do most of the working and paying and living in Zion's community. Well, is it too much to have them work and pay and live and die in a couple of decent rooms in a bath? My father didn't think so. People were human beings to him. But to you, a warped, frustrated old man, they're cattle. Well, in my book, my father died a much richer man than you'll ever be.
I'm not interested in your book, young man. I'm talking about the building and loan.
I know very well what you're talking about. You're talking about something you can't get your fingers on. And it's galling you. That's what you're talking about. Well, thank you for stopping by, Mr. Potter. I'll see you at the meeting.
But you're not on the board.
I hold my father's proxy so I can attend and cast a vote. You see, the way I look at it, Mr. Potter, the people of this town and our family's one horse institution, it only has some place where they can go without crawling to you.
Get me out of here. Sentimental hogwash. I'm still going to make my motion, young man, and we'll see who has the power in this town.
You spoke eloquently at the board meeting that day, and they turned Potter down.
Remember? But on one condition I hadn't banked on.
That you take your father's place.
And you did. And you turned over all your school money to your brother Harry and sent him off to college. And Harry became a football star. He's second team All-American. And you? Well, you got 4 years older.
Hello, Mom.
What are you doing? Wishing on the moon?
No. I've given up on that. Just getting some air.
Did you know that Mary Hatch is back from school?
Uh-huh.
Came back 3 days ago.
Mm-hmm.
Nice girl, Mary. Kind that will help you find the answers, George.
Mm-hmm.
Can you give me one good reason why you shouldn't call on Mary?
Sure. Sam Wainwright.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, Sam's crazy about Mary.
Well, she's not crazy about him.
Well, how do you know? Did she discuss it with you?
No.
Well, how do you know then?
Well, I've got eyes, haven't I? Why does she light up like a firefly whenever you're around?
Oh.
And besides, Sam Wainwright's away in New York and you're here in Bedford Falls.
And all's fair in love and war?
Well, I don't know about war.
Mother, you know I can see right through you. Right to your back collar button. Trying to get rid of me, huh?
Uh-huh.
All right. Mother, old building and loan pal, if you insist, I'll go out and find a girl and do a little passionate necking.
George!
That's pointing in the right direction. This direction? Good night, Mrs. Bailey.
Hello, Georgie Forgie.
Hello, Violet. How's business at the old-fashioned permanent wave shop?
Not a tidal wave yet, but I'm getting some city mothers in thanks to you. What gives with you?
Nothing.
Where are you going?
I'll probably end up down to the library.
Georgie, don't you ever get tired of just reading about things?
Yes. Yes, I do. What are you doing tonight?
Not a thing.
Are you getting by? Let's make a night of it.
Oh, I love it, Georgie. What do we do?
go out in the field and take up our shoes and walk through the grass.
Huh?
Then we can climb to the top of Mount Bedford, up to the falls and smell the pines and watch the sunrise against the peaks. And we can stay up there the whole night and everybody will be talking and there will be a terrific scandal.
In the grass in my bare feet. George, have you gone crazy? And Mount Bedford? Who'd want to climb all the way to the top of Mount Bedford? It's got to be a 10-mile hike at least.
Yeah, it's just a crazy idea.
You're telling me. Good night, George. Well, there you are.
Hello, Mary. I just went for a walk and happened to be passing by.
Yes, so I noticed. Have you made up your mind?
How's that?
Have you made up your mind?
About what?
Paying a visit. Your mother phoned and said you're on your way over.
Mother called you? Well, how did she know?
Didn't you tell her?
I didn't tell anybody. I just went for a walk and happened to be passing by.
Well, do you want to come up on the porch and sit a minute?
Well, maybe 4 minutes. When did you get back?
Tuesday.
Where did you get the dress?
Do you like it?
It's okay. I thought you'd go back to New York with Sam and Angie in the restaurant.
Oh, I worked for a couple of vacations, but I don't know. I guess I was just homesick.
Homesick? For Bedford Falls?
Yes, and my family and, oh, everything. Aren't you coming up on the porch?
Well, maybe just for a minute. But I want you to know I didn't tell anybody I was coming over here.
Would you rather leave?
No! I mean, I don't want to be rude.
Then come on up.
Gals, can't you come out tonight? Can't you come out tonight? Can't you come out tonight? Buffalo gals, can't you come out tonight and dance by the light of the moon?
Mary, stand there, you.
It's George Bailey, Mother.
George Bailey? What does he want?
I don't know.
What do you want?
Me? Not a thing.
He's making violent love to me, Mother!
Go right back home and don't you leave the house either. Same way that I promised to call you from New York tonight. There he is now. Good night, George.
I better be going.
No, wait a minute, Mary.
Steal my girl?
What? No one's trying to steal your girl. Here's Mary.
No, wait a minute. I want to talk to the both of you. Tell Mary to get on the extension.
Once you get on the extension?
Mother's on the extension. Now we can both hear that. We're listening, Sam.
I have a big deal coming up that's going to make us all rich. George, you remember that night in Martini's bar when you ran someplace about making plastic out of soybeans?
What? Soybeans, yeah, sure.
Well, Dad snapped up the idea, and he's going to build a factory outside of Rochester, and here's the point. Mary, you're on this too. Now listen, George, have you got any money?
Money? Yeah, well, a little.
Well, now listen up. I want you to put every cent you got into our stock. You hear? And George, I may have a job for you. That is, unless you're still married to that broken-down building model. This is the biggest thing since radio, and I'm letting you in the ground floor. Oh, Mary.
I'm here.
Will you tell that guy I'm giving him a chance of a lifetime, you hear? A chance of a lifetime.
He says it's the chance of a lifetime.
Hey, listen to me. I don't want any plastics, I don't want any ground floors, and I don't want to get married, ever, to anyone. You understand that? I want to do what I want to do. And you're...
Thank you.
Thank you.
So, where are you two going on this island?
Where are we going? Look at this. Here, count it, Mary.
I feel like a bootlegger's wife.
I'm going to shoot the works. A whole week in New York, a whole week in Bermuda, the highest hotels, the oldest champagne, the richest caviar, the hottest music, and the prettiest wife.
Well, that does it. Then what?
Then what, honey?
After that, who cares?
That does it. Come here.
I hate to interrupt anything, but there's something funny going on down at the bank. I'm no expert, but it has all the earmarks of a run.
Oh my God.
You need to get your money out of the bank, folks. We need to do it now.
Wait, here, dear. I'll be just a minute.
George, let's not stop. Please, let's go.
I'll be back in a minute, Mary. What's the meaning of this, Uncle Billy? A holiday?
This is what you call pickle, George. We're at pickle.
All right, now, what happened? How did it start?
How did anything like this start? All I know is the bank called our loan.
When?
About an hour ago. They took all of our cash.
All of it?
Every cent of it. They're still us what we owe.
Holy mackerel!
The whole town's gone crazy.
Mr. Potter, to what do we owe this unexpected visit?
George, there's a rumor around town that you're going to close your doors early. Is that true?
Not for another 10 minutes. It's our regular closing time.
Well, I'm glad to hear that. George, are you all right? Do you want me to call the police?
What's for?
Mobs can get pretty ugly sometimes, you know.
I can assure you, all of our customers are very polite.
I'm sure. George, I'm going all out to help in this crisis. I've just guaranteed the bank sufficient funds to meet their needs. They'll close down for a week and then reopen.
You've taken over the bank?
I may lose a fortune, but I'm willing to guarantee your people too. Just bring your shares over to the bank and I will pay 50 cents on the dollar.
50 cents on the dollar? I'm sure that won't be necessary, Mr. Potter. We'll take care of our customers right here.
Well, just make sure you don't close your doors before 6 p.m. or you'll never reopen. Ladies, gentlemen, remember, 50 cents on the dollar.
You never miss a trick. See you, Mr. Potter. Well, you're going to miss this one. All right, folks, don't panic. I heard Mr. Potter. The bank will reopen in a week.
But I have my money here, George, and I want it now.
Oh, Miss Andrews, you're thinking of this place all wrong. As if I had the money somewhere back inside of the safe. The money's not here. The money's in the Granger's house, right next to yours. And Miss Macklin's house, and in the Kennedy house, and 100 others. Why, you're giving them the money to build, and they're going to pay it back to you as best they can. Now what are you going to do? Foreclose on them?
I have $242 in here, George Bailey. And $242 isn't going to break anybody.
All right, Miss Andrews. All right. Sign this. Get your money in 60 days.
60 days?
Well, now this week, appreciate when you bought the shares. Miss Andrews, please! Stick to your original agreement. Give us 60 days on this.
Are you going to go to Thomas?
Better to get half than nothing.
Wait, Miss Andrews! Mrs. Thompson, wait, please! Listen! Listen to me! Potter gets hold of this building alone. There will never be another decent house built in this town. He's already got charge of the bank. He's got the department stores. He's got the bus line. And now he's after us. Why? Because we're cutting in on his business, that's why. And because he wants to keep you living in his slums and paying the kind of rent he decides. Well, we can't let him. We can get through this thing if we just stick together. We've got to have faith in each other.
But my husband hasn't worked in over a year, and I need money.
How am I going to live? Is the bank open?
We have doctor bills to pay.
I can't feed my kids on faith.
How much do you need?
Money. Hey. That's right. I've got $2,000. I've got $2,000 here. This will tide us over until the bank reopens. All right, Mrs. Andrews, how much do you want?
$242.
Oh, Miss Andrews, please. Just enough to tide you over until the bank reopens.
I'll take $242.
There you are.
That'll close my account.
Your account's still here. That's just the loan. All right, Mr. Gower.
I need $300, George.
Oh, Mr. Gower, please. Just enough to tidy over until the bank reopens. How much do you need?
I suppose about 20.
20? Now you're talking. $20. All right, Mrs. Thompson,
But it's your own money, George.
Never mind about that. How much do you need?
Well, I can get a loan of 20, all right.
There you are.
Can I sign a paper?
You don't have to sign anything. I need to pay back when you can. That's all right. All right, Mrs. Martini.
Could we have 1750?
17. Push your heart, of course you can have it. You got 50 cents? Here, you take my money. Hello, Mrs. Bailey.
Hello, Mr. Bailey. How's it been?
Booming.
Well, at least you have a place to come home to.
What are you talking about?
32 Sycamore.
32 Sycamore? With that.
Remember the night we broke the windows? Well, that's what I've wished for, and I've been saving ever since. Happy anniversary.
Happy anniversary? We've only been married an hour.
1 hour, 29 minutes, and 40 some odd seconds to be exact. Soon enough to celebrate, I would say, wouldn't you?
Oh, darling. You're wonderful.
4, 5, 6, bingo! We made it! Look, George, we're still in business! We got 2 bucks left! Call the champagne! Let's make a couple of financial wizards!
Rockefeller?
Open the safe for these great big important simoleons!
Well, save one for seed!
Here's the Papa Dollar and some Mama Dollar. And if you want to keep the old building alone in business, you better have a family real quick!
I wish they were rabbits!
That's great, Aunt Tilly! Did you hear Uncle Billy? Rabbits! Here's to the rabbits! Rabbits!
Bread, that this house may never know hunger. Salt, that life may always have flavor.
And wine, that joy and prosperity may reign forever. Enter the Martini Castle.
You can't dismiss this Bailey Park anymore, Mr. Potter. It's cutting deeper and deeper into your rental profits.
The Bailey family's been a boil on my neck for long enough.
Mr. Bailey has just arrived, sir.
Good. Tell him to wait. Go on.
As you know, he's built up a whole subdivision up next to the cemetery. Dozens and dozens of the prettiest little homes you ever saw. I'm thinking seriously of purchasing one myself.
Don't you dare!
The point is, Mr. Potter, 90% of the residents used to pay rent to you. Now if I were you, Mr. Potter...
Well, you are not me.
As I say, I'm just a lowly bank examiner. But if you're not careful, one of these days...
I'm a busy man, Miss Carter. I haven't got time for idle conjecture. Good day. Cut into my revenue, will you? I'll show you a trick or two, Mr. Bailey.
Yes, sir?
Send Bailey in.
Right away, sir. Mr. Bailey, Mr. Potter will see you now.
Thank you.
Good morning, George. So good to see you again.
Mr. Potter. Quite an unusual request.
What's that?
You're calling to ask me to pay you a visit.
You don't know what's so unusual about it. I just thought we should get better acquainted. Here, have a cigar.
Thank you, sir. It's quite a cigar.
You like it? I'll send you a box.
I suppose I'll find this out sooner or later. But what exactly did you see me about?
Now that's just what I like so much about you. George, I'm an old man, and most people hate me. But I don't like him either, so that makes it all even. You know as well as I do that, for a number of years, I run practically everything in this town. You also know that I've been trying to get control of the building loan, or kill it, but I haven't been able to do it. You've been stopping. In fact, you have beaten me. And as anyone in this town can tell you, that takes some doing. Take during the Depression, for instance. You and I were the only two that could keep our heads. You saved the building loan, and I saved all the rest.
Yes, well, Most people say you stole all the rest.
The envious ones say that, George. The suckers. Now, I have stated my side very frankly. Let's talk about you. Young man, age 27, 28. Married, making, say, 40 a week.
45.
Out of which, after supporting your wife and mother, and paying your bills, you're able to keep, say, 10, if you skip. But a child or two comes along, you won't even be able to keep that. Now, if this young man of 28 were a common, ordinary yokel, I'd say he was doing fine. But George Bailey is not a common, ordinary yokel. He is an intelligent, smart, ambitious young man who hates his job, who hates the building and loan, almost as much as I do. A young man who's been dying to get out on his own ever since he was born. A young man, the smartest of the crowd, mind you. A young man who has had to sit by and watch his friends go places. A young man who has had to trapped, frittering his life away, playing nursemaid to a lot of garden keepers. Do I paint the correct picture, or do I exaggerate?
Now what is your point, Mr. Potter?
My point? My point is that I want you to hire me.
Hire me?
I want you to manage my accounts, run my properties. I'll start you out at $20,000 a year.
$20,000 a year?
You wouldn't mind living in the nicest house in town, buying your wife a lot of fine clothing, a couple of business trips to New York a year, maybe even Europe. You wouldn't mind that, would you, George?
Would I? Mr. Potter! We're not talking to anybody else around here, are you? You know, this is me, George Bailey.
Oh, yes. George Bailey, whose ship has just set sail, provided he has the brains to climb aboard.
What about building alone?
Confounded man. Are you afraid of success? I have just offered you a 3-year contract, starting at $20,000 a year. Is it a deal or isn't it?
Well, Mr. Potter, I know I ought to jump to the chance, but I wonder if it would be possible for you to give me 24 hours to think it over for you.
Oh, sure, sure. You go over and talk it over with your wife.
I'd like to do that.
In the meantime, I'll draw the papers.
All right, sir.
Okay, George.
No! I don't have to talk it over with anybody, because I know right now the answer is no! No, dadgone it, you! You sit around here, spinning your little webs, thinking the whole world revolves around you and your money! Well, it doesn't, Mr. Potter! And the whole vast configuration of things has to hear nothing but a scurvy little spider! You! Duh! And that goes for you, too!
Hi.
Been a rough day?
Sure.
Buffalo gals, can't you come out tonight? Buffalo gals, can't you come out tonight and dance by the light of the moon?
Mary Hatch, why in the world did you ever marry a guy like me?
To keep from being an old maid.
You married Sam Wainwright or anybody else in Texas.
I want my baby to look like you.
You never even had a honeymoon. I promise you. Door what?
My baby.
You mean, Mary? Are you on the nest?
In a manner of speaking.
What is it? A boy or a girl?
You were on top of the world then, George Bailey. Couldn't have been happier.
That was nearly 2 years ago. Gone through a war since then.
Yes. And your wife has given birth to not one, but 4 beautiful children. And your brother Harry was decorated with the Congressional Medal of Honor. President decorates Harry Bailey.
That was the headline in this morning's paper.
That's right. This morning, day before Christmas, about 10 a.m. That's when it all began, wasn't it? You were out buying a Christmas wreath. And Uncle Billy. Oh yes, Uncle Billy was on his way to the bank.
Read all about it! Local boy wins Congressional Medal of Honor! Harry Bailey to be decorated by President!
Here, give me one of those. One of those baby boys again.
Well, good morning, Mr. Potter. What's the news?
Well, Harry Bailey wins Congressional Medal of Honor.
You're one of those Bailey boys now, can't you? Down these days, can you, Mr. Potter?
How does Slacker George feel about it?
Very jealous. Oh, yes, very jealous. He only lost three buttons off his vest. Of course, Slacker George would have won at least two though, had he been allowed to go.
I know. He has a bad ear.
That's right. And you know, Mr. Potter, not every heel is in Germany and Japan.
Give me back my paper. Get your own if you want to drool over it. Wait. Hey! Hey! Wait a minute. Why not? Yes, why not? Take me straight to the bank.
Extra, extra, read all about it.
George is Harry now in long distance from Washington.
Harry? What do you know about that?
He reversed the charges. It's okay, isn't it?
What do you mean, is it okay? For a hero? Here, let me speak to him. Harry! Oh, you old seven times son of a gun! Congratulations! How's Mother sending it? She did? What do you know about that? Mother had looked for the president's wife.
Wait till Bill hears about this. What did they have to eat?
What did you have to eat? Oh, Harry, wait till you see what the town's cooking up for you. Oh, are they? The Navy's going to find Mother home this afternoon.
On a plane?
Uncle Billy? Has Uncle Billy come in yet?
No, he stopped at the bank first.
He's not here right now. But Harry, look.
George.
Now tell me about it.
But George, that woman's here again.
Woman? What woman?
Bank.
Here. Talk to Aunt Silly again a minute, will you? I'll be right back. Hello, Violet.
George, can I see you for a second?
Oh, of course you can. Just step into my office. I'll be right there. Hello, Miss
Carter. Bank examiner.
Miss Carter. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
We're all excited around here. My brother just got the Congressional Medal of Honor. The president decorated him.
Well, I guess they do those things. I trust you had a good year.
Good year? Well, between you and me, Miss Carter, we're broke.
Very funny.
Now, you step right in here, Miss Carter.
Although I shouldn't wonder when you okay reverse charges on personal long-distance calls.
George, shall I hang up?
No. He wants to talk to Uncle Billy. You just hold on.
Now, if you'll cooperate, I'd like to finish with you by tonight. I want to spend Christmas now tomorrow with my sister and her family.
And I don't blame you at all, Miss Carter. Now, if you'll just step right in here, Uncle Billy has everything all laid out for you.
Hurry, Uncle Billy, hurry! Long distance, Washington!
Not now, can't talk to anyone now.
But it's your nephew Harry, remember? Here's your Uncle Billy, Harry.
Hello? Yes? Harry? Everything's fine.
Mr. Bailey!
What? Oh, yes.
Oh, another Mr. Bailey. Well, you'll do just fine. Possibly better. May I see you in here for a moment, please? I have some questions.
Oh, dear, oh, dear. Boss, sir? Yes, of course you can. I'll be right there. Where's George?
In his office with Violet Peterson.
Oh, dear. I'll be seeing as soon as he gets out.
Character? If I had any character, I'd...
It takes a lot of character. I'm going hometown and start all over again.
No, George, don't.
Here. Now you're first.
I know, but...
What do you want to do? Hawk your furs and that hat? Wants to walk to New York. You know, they charge for meals and rent up there just the same as they do in Bedford Falls.
Yeah, sure.
It's a loan. That's my business, building a loan. Besides, you'll get a job. Good luck to you.
I'm glad I know you, George Bailey.
Say hello to New York for me.
Yeah, sure I will.
And let's hear from you. Merry Christmas, Bob.
Merry Christmas, George. Mr. Bailey, there seems to be a problem.
A problem? How do you mean?
George, can I speak to you for a minute? Please?
Billy, what is it?
Oh, George.
What?
Oh, that's bad.
No?
I think you didn't hear me.
I'm afraid so. How much? That much? Are you sure? Now look, did you buy anything?
No, nothing. Not even a stick of gum.
Are you sure you have the money with you?
Yes, I was counting it, I think.
You think?
Uncle Billy, we've got to find the money.
Oh, George, I'm so sorry. I'm just not...
Now listen to me. Listen to me. Do you have any secret hiding places in your house? Someplace you could put it?
No.
Someplace to hide the money?
No, nothing like that.
Now listen to me. Listen to me. Think!
I've been thinking, George. I have, and I can't think anymore.
Listen, you stupid, silly old fool, where's the money? Do you realize what this means? It means bankruptcy, and scandal, and prison!
No, no, no!
Yes, that's exactly what it means. Well, no one's going to jail. Well, it's not going to be me!
Did you bring a wreath?
Daddy, did you bring a Christmas wreath?
Wreath? What wreath?
The Christmas wreath from the window.
No, I left it at the office.
Is it snowing?
Yeah, just started.
Where's your coat and hat?
I left them at the office.
What's the matter?
Nothing's the matter. Everything is all right.
Isn't it wonderful about Harry? We're famous, George. I bet I had 50 calls today about the parade and the bakery. Your mother's so excited.
Must she keep playing that?
She's practicing for the party tonight, Daddy.
Mommy can stay till midnight and sing Christmas carols.
You can stay up too, Daddy.
Daddy, the rabbit's door in the car. You should see it.
But what's the matter with our car? Isn't it good enough for you?
Better hurry and shave, George. The families will be here soon.
Families? I don't want the families over here. Zuzu, what's the matter with you?
Oh, she's got a cold. Had it coming home from school. They gave her a flower surprise, and she didn't want to crush it, so she didn't button up her coat. Go to bed, darling.
I want to give my flower a drink.
What do you have, Zuzu? A sore throat or what?
Just a cold. The doctor says it's nothing serious.
Doctor? Was the doctor here?
Yes, I called him right away. He says it's nothing to worry about.
Are you running a temperature, little one?
I don't think so.
Just the teensy one. 99.6. She'll be all right.
Better get back upstairs, Susan. The floor is cold.
Flower, she wants a drink.
Now!
I'll bring the basin with some water up in a minute. Go along.
It's this old house! I don't know why we all have pneumonia. Might as well be living in a barn! This dusty old refrigerator! Why would I ever live in the first place to stick around this measly, crummy old town?
George, what's wrong?
Daddy, how do you spell princesses?
I don't know. Ask your mother.
Telephone.
I'll get it.
Hello? Yes, this is Miss Bailey. Oh, thank you, Mrs. Welch. I'm sure she'll be all right. The doctor said that she ought to be out of time in bed to have her Christmas dinner.
Is that Zuzu's teacher?
Yes.
Let me speak to her. Hello? Mrs. Welch? This is George Bailey. I'm Zuzu's father. Say, what kind of a teacher are you anyway? Sitting in your home like that, half naked? Do you realize you're probably eating with pneumonia on account of you?
George!
Is this the sort of thing we pay taxes for? To have teachers like you? Silly, stupid, careless people sitting in our kids without any clothes on? You know what? Maybe my kids aren't the best dressed kids. Maybe they don't have any decent clothes at all! Oh, stupid!
Hello? Miss Welch, I'd like to apologize. Hello? Hello? She hung up.
I'll hang her up! I'll get it. Hello? Who is this? Oh, Mr. Welch! I'm so glad you called! Give me a chance to tell you what I really think of your wife! Oh, you will, huh? All right, Mr. Welch. Anytime you think you're man enough to... Hello? Hello? Done! Hung up! What do you think I am? A dictionary? Jamie! Have you learned that silly tune yet? You played it over and over and over! Now stop it! Stop it! I need your help, Mr. Potter. There's some sort of accident. My company shortened their accounts. The bank examiner's up there today. I need to raise $8,000 immediately.
Oh, so that's what the reporters wanted to talk to you about.
A reporter?
Yes, they called me up from the building in loan. There's a man from the DA's office there, too. He's looking for you.
Oh, Mr. Potter, help me. Help me, won't you, please? Can't you see what it means to my family? I'll pay you any sort of bonus on the loan. Any interest!
Mr.
still want the building alone. Why? Ah, George, is there a possibility that there's a slight discrepancy in the books?
Sir, there's nothing wrong with the books. I've just misplaced $8,000. I can't find it anywhere.
You've misplaced $8,000?
Yes, sir.
Have you notified the police?
No, sir. I don't want the publicity. Harry's homecoming tomorrow.
They're going to believe that one. What have you been doing, George? Playing the markets with the company's money?
No, sir, I haven't!
What is it? A woman, then? You know it's all over town that you've been giving money to Violet Peterson.
What?
Not that it matters to me, but why did you come to me to ask for help? Why not go to Sam Wainwright?
He's in Europe. I can't get hold of him.
What about any of your other friends?
They don't have that kind of money, Mr. Potter. You know that. You're the only one in town that can help me.
I see. I've suddenly become quite important. What kind of securities would I have? Have you any real estate?
No, sir.
Stocks, bonds, collateral of any kind?
I have some life insurance. A $15,000 policy.
Good. How much is your equity in it?
$500.
Look at you. You used to be so cocky. You were going to go out and conquer the world. You once called me a warped, frustrated old man. Well, what are you but a warped, frustrated young man? A miserable little clerk, crawling in here on your hands and knees and begging for help. No stocks, no bonds, just a measly $500 equity in a life insurance policy. You're worth more dead than alive, George. You know why you don't go to the riffraff you love so much and ask them for the money? Because they'd run you out of town on a rail. But I'll tell you what I'm going to do for you, George. While the state examiner is here, as a stockholder in the building and loan, I'm going to swear out a warrant for your arrest.
No!
Misappropriation of funds, manipulation, malfeasance.
No! No! No!
Go ahead, George. You can't hide in a little town like this.
Oh, God! Got to help me out here!
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room.
Not tonight, Mr. Martini.
Did he just call you George Bailey?
That's right. This is Mr. George Bailey, brother of the...
No! And the next time you talk to my wife like that, you'll get worse! She cried for an hour and wouldn't even come out with us tonight!
It's enough, Mr. Welch, that's enough!
It's enough that she slaves away, teaching your stupid kids how to read and write, and you had to bawl her out!
Mr. Welch!
Oh, to heck with it! I'm going home!
Come on, everybody, this is Christmas Eve! We are supposed to be spreading good cheer.
Yes. Aren't we going to sing anymore?
Yes, we are. Come on.
Are you all right?
Sure.
You want us to take you home?
No!
I'll be fine. I'm waiting for someone.
You sure?
Where's my life insurance policy?
What?
Just leave me alone. Please, just leave me alone!
Are you coming?
We'll be right there. You sure you'll be all right, George?
I'm sure. Thank you.
Well then, Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. Oh, God. Oh, God. Father in heaven, I'm not a praying man. But if you're up there and you can hear me, please show me the way. I'm at the end of my rope. Please show me the way, God. Please.
And that's where I came in.
You mean you actually heard my prayer up there?
Yours and over a dozen others. You'd be surprised how many people care about you, George.
When they find out I've ruined their lives.
But you haven't ruined their lives. Besides, It wasn't your fault. I'm the president of the company. I'm the one to be held accountable. Just ask Mr. Potter. He'll tell you if you think killing yourself would make everyone feel happier.
I don't know. I suppose it'd be better if I hadn't been born at all.
What'd you say?
I said, I wish I'd never been born.
Oh, you mustn't say things like that, you.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute.
That's an idea. That's an idea. What do you think?
Yeah.
All right, that'll do. There. You've never been born. You've never been born. You don't exist. You haven't a care in the world. No worries, no obligations, no $8,000. No Potter looking for you as a sheriff.
Say something else in that ear.
Sure, you can hear out of it.
Is the dog going to stay? I haven't heard anything out of that ear since I was a kid. What's going on here?
We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas.
Hey! There's two more suckers over there! Let's sing them!
We wish you a Merry Christmas.
Some? That's my name and this is my poison. You want some?
Mr. Martin! Did you recognize me?
Dominic! He knows your name! Now you've got to sing to him!
Where's your watch? Mrs. Martin!
She's home! They're all home! And that makes it a Merry Christmas, doesn't it, dear?
Well, I saw her 2 minutes ago! Her and lots of women and children, too!
Where? What are you talking about? Hey, you're not going to snitch on us, are you?
Wait a minute. I know you. You hit me just a minute ago.
I did? Did you hit that? I already hit it. Did it hurt? Let me try it again.
Oh, leave the sucker alone. He's probably worse off than we are.
Look, here comes that panhandler again.
Come on, let's get out of here.
Hey, one of you got a dime or two you can spare? Or a drink? I'll sell them for a drink.
Mr. Gower, it's me, George Bailey. Don't you remember me?
Come on, I tell you, I don't like hanging around this guy.
You own the corner drugstore. I used to work for you when I was a kid. Remember?
Now I know I don't like you. That runhead spent 20 years in jail for poisoning a kid.
Yeah, and if you know him, you must be a jailbird yourself. Come on.
Wait. Wait a minute.
Wait a minute.
You see, George? You weren't there to stop.
Wasn't down. There? What do you mean I wasn't there? I remember distinctly. Look, who are you?
I've been trying to tell you, George. I'm your guardian angel. I know everything about you.
I don't get it.
You got what you wanted, what you wished for. What don't you understand? You were never born.
I wasn't born. But if I wasn't born, who am I?
You're no one. You don't have an identity.
No identity? What do you mean, no identity? My name is George Bailey. I was born July 12th, 1907, right here in Bedford Falls.
You won't find any public records of it. Besides, this isn't Bedford Falls anymore. This is Pottersville.
Pottersville? No! No, no!
That's right. And there is no George Bailey. Never has been. You see, George, you've got a wonderful gift. What you asked for. A chance to see what the world would be like without you.
Pilot!
That's what they call me.
Am I glad to see you?
Well, I'm glad to see you too. New in town? Who gave you my name?
I'm George. George Bailey.
Of course you are. And if anyone asks, I've never seen or even heard of you before.
Well, you have. I'm George Bailey. We grew up together.
I don't think so, good looking, but I sure wish we had.
You've got to remember.
Well, I've got a life. You want to tell me about
it? Her name is Violet Peterson. We were born in 1910. No, 1911. And you graduated right here from the local high school.
Wait a minute. What are you? Some sort of private eye? I should have known. Don't you guys ever give it a rest. It's Christmas Eve, for God's sake.
Violet, you don't understand.
Oh, yes, I do. See no evil, hear no evil, speak no evil. That's my motto, so give it a rest and get out of here.
Violet, please.
Or I'll make a telephone call, George, or whatever your name is. And I don't think you want me to do that. Merry Christmas.
Violet! Violet! Boarding house? What's going on here?
Well, what do you want? If you're looking for a room, there's no vacancy.
No, wait, please. I'm lost. I need to sort things out. Please let me in.
I told you I've got no vacancy. Besides, I don't take in strangers unless they're referred by someone. Try over on Maple Street, 163 Maple.
Your brother-in-law, Uncle Billy.
How do you know him?
I've seen him around.
When? When did you see him around?
Today, over at his house.
That's a lie. He's been in the state asylum for over 5 years, ever since he lost his business.
Harry! Your son, Harry!
My only son broke through the ice and was drowned at the age of 9.
No, he's alive. He's a hero. He went to war and got the Congressional Medal of Honor. He's coming home tomorrow.
I'm going to call the police.
He saved the life of every man on that transport. It was the headlines in all the papers.
Every man on that transport died because Harry wasn't there to save them, because you weren't there to save Harry. You see, George, you really had a wonderful life. Don't you see what a waste it would be to throw it all away?
Parents?
Yes, George?
Where's Mammy?
Oh, well, see.
If you know where she is, just tell me.
You aren't going to like it, George.
Where is she? Is she alive?
Yes, she's alive, but she isn't the Mary you know. Something happens.
Mary!
Who are you? What do you want?
Mary!
Get away from me! I'll scream!
Mary! What happened to us?
I don't know what you're talking about.
I'm George. I'm your husband, George.
No, no, leave me alone. Don't touch me.
Mary, please.
Somebody help. Please help.
Mary. Mary.
There's got to be an easier way for me to get my wings.
Clarence. 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 Help me, Clarence, please. I want it back. I want it back. I want to live again. I don't care what happens. Just give me back to my wife and my kids and my friends! Please, Clarence! Please! Please! Please!
Hey, George! George, are you okay? What's the matter?
I didn't do anything to her! Honest!
What are you talking about? What the same noise are you yelling for, George?
Don't! George? George? Do you know me?
Know you? We've been looking all over town for you.
Mary!
Yeah, Mary called. And so did Martini and your Uncle Billy. And even your mother called. So what's going on, George?
What's going on? I look around you. It's breathing, it's moving, it's alive! Merry Christmas! Merry Christmas!
I think we better take the call.
No, I'm fine. Honestly, I'm fine. Mary! 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 Well, hello, Miss Bailey Examiner.
Mr. Bailey, you have a deficit we must talk about.
Yes. Isn't it wonderful? Mwah! Merry Christmas! Mary! Oh, look at this house. This wonderful, drafty old house! Mary! Have you seen my wife?
Merry Christmas, Daddy!
Oh, you kids! You wonderful, wonderful kids! How did you see you up? Where's your mother?
She was looking for you with Uncle Billy. George, darling! Oh, hello.
Hallelujah!
George, darling, where have you been?
Oh, Mary, let me touch you. Oh, you're real!
Oh,
George!
You have no idea what just happened to me!
You have no idea what happened to me! Come on now. You stand right here by the tree and don't leave. Stand right here. I can hear them coming, George. It's a miracle! A miracle! Come in, Uncle Billy! Everybody in here!
Isn't it wonderful, George? Very good. Show a few people you're in trouble, they scattered all over town collecting money. Didn't ask any questions. Just says, George is in trouble, count on me. Never seen anything like it.
What is this, George? Another run on the bed?
I wouldn't have a roof over my head if it wasn't for you, George. Merry Christmas. Glad it's
here. Any time for you, Mr. Bailey?
I made the rounds on all my charge accounts, George.
I'm not going to go, George. I changed my mind.
Just a minute. Quiet, everybody. Quiet now. This is from London. Mr. Gower cables you need cash stock. My company instructed to advance you up to $25,000 stock. Merry Christmas, Sam Wainwright.
George?
Harry! Harry!
Looks like I got here just in time. Anybody got any wine? Champagne? I want to make a toast. My big brother George, the richest man in town. I forgot. Some crazy little old man handed me this at the airport. If he promised to deliver it to you personally.
Tom Sawyer? Who would give you an old day of coffee to Tom Sawyer?
Dear George, remember no man is a failure who has friends. Thanks for the wings. Love, Clarence. A Christmas present from a very dear friend of mine. Just like all of you. Merry Christmas, everybody!
Merry Christmas!
Listen, Daddy.
What is it, darling?
Hear the bell? Teacher says every time a bell rings, that angel makes his wings.
Let's rise! Let's rise! Attaboy, Clarence.